we're doing a good job, stripped off that brown paint off the columns. But for those of you that know, paint stripper is very caustic. And it stripped the stone of mineral, and it also etched the glass. So we'll be removing every piece of glass in these columns and rebacking them. And those of you there can't see it, but we've restored a small portion right here. And it's absolutely gorgeous. Black stone with glass with gold foil on the back. It's going to transform the entryway. Now again, this was all part of Tiffany's vision for this house. Just extraordinarily unusual, very exotic and appealing. Tiffany had traveled as a young man through Egypt and was heavily influenced by the artwork he saw there, and much of what he did was influenced by that work as well. The floors will also be restoring. They are mosaic. They are not only marble, green marble, but there's green glass in the floor too. And that green is of course picked up in the green in the glass, and then the green in the walls. You can't see it because the insurance company parged the walls. But underneath that parging is green marble. And so we've exposed just a little area of that green marble that we'll be completely exposing once we get the funds to do that. So this whole area glowed green. Tiffany's taking you from the outside in. The vestibule beyond there is yellow marble, and then you're going to get into the hallway, which is white marble. So Tiffany's guiding you from the outside, green, yellow, white, inside. So everything carefully thought through and planned. So come on in. We're going to sit in the parlor, and I'll tell you a little bit more about his design. He designed, we think, about four houses in Manhattan for private clients, and then his biggest project, which was Laurelton Hall, which was his summer home on Long Island. All those houses in Manhattan, by the way, were demolished by the next generation. And Laurelton Hall burned to the ground in 1957. So this is really it. This is the last surviving house that he worked on from the ground up. Now, there are other houses that he was brought in to redecorate, which was, you know, all the rage, the same way it is today. Once you're a famous designer, people want you to come in and touch what they've done. So one of the most famous examples of that is the Mark Twain House in Hartford. I don't know if any of you have been there, but Tiffany was brought in to redesign that by Mark Twain. But you can see there how he was constrained by the architecture. He had nothing to do with the architecture there. So he really relied mostly on doing stenciling and some other decorative work, but he couldn't do the type of work that he usually likes to do. The other example where you can see some of Tiffany's work is at the Morse Museum in Winter Park, Florida. It's actually an area right near Orlando. It's an exquisite little historic town. Who knew there were historic towns in Orlando? But it is gem of a museum. And what they've done is they've taken some rooms from Laurelton Hall. They salvaged them from the fire and have completely recreated them down in this museum. So if you ever get a chance to see it, I would highly recommend it. It's absolutely stunning. And then, of course, there are a few pieces that have survived that are at the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York City. The columns that were on the front of Laurelton Hall, for instance, are still there. But this is really it, to see a complete intact Tiffany house. Most people don't really know that Tiffany did interior design. Everybody knows him for his lamps and his stained glass, but all the work that he ended up doing on specifically his lighting, all emerged from his interest in interiors and residential work. He traveled as a young man, as I mentioned, in Egypt, and was interested in becoming an artist, but then very quickly moved into interior design. He felt that Victorian bric-a-brac and exuberance was just out of control, that there was no uniformity to it, it didn't express a masterpiece, and he wanted to change all that. So his work was always striving to be connected and have everything work together. This house was built for Frederick Ayer and his second wife, Ellen Banning Ayer. Ellen was 30 years younger than Frederick. And we really think that she was the reason that this house was built. She was living in the first wife's houses out in Lowell and in Beverly. And we think she wanted a place she could really call her own. She was a trained actress, and we also think that she wanted to be in Boston because the theater was here, you know, it wasn't out in Lowell. So She probably convinced her husband that, you know, this was a much more interesting place socially and for the theater to build here in Boston. But they weren't Bostonians, and we think they knew they weren't going to be welcomed by Boston society. So on the theory, you know, if we can't join you, we'll beat you, they bring up Tiffany from New York, who's really active in New York. They bring him up here to design their castle, so to show Bostonians how it's being done in New York. They lived in this house from 1902 until 1918. In 1918, they both died. Frederick Ayer was in his 90s. He was out horseback riding and caught a cold that quickly progressed to pneumonia. But of course, remember, it was the year of the Spanish flu, so he may also have died of the flu, we just don't know. And then she died 3 months later, and we also don't know how and why she died. The family lore, of course, that she died of a broken heart, but she had a congenital heart defect, and we think she might have succumbed to it that year as well. But the house went out of the family after they died. Nobody wanted it. And the reason was because in 1918, Tiffany was already starting to look a little bit dated. After World War I, people were looking for styles that were a little more modern, and this was looked way too ornate for most tastes of that era. So the house was sold to a succession of businesses that operated out of here until the 1960s, when this house was bought by the current owner. But the most interesting owner of the building for about 7 or 8 years was the Boston Evening Clinic. It was sort of a precursor to a Medicare, Medicaid. It was doctors that were willing to work at night for a lower pay, so that people who might lose their job during the day if they tried to go to a doctor's appointment could come and get low-cost medical care at night. So they operated out of here for about 7 years. And then the building was bought in the 1950s by an insurance company. And they're really the ones that undid the Tiffany. By the 1950s, Tiffany was really out of favor. And the CEO in particular hated the look of this building. So he had a lot of it gutted, and including this room. This served as his office. And they ripped everything off the walls. They put in a drop ceiling, and they put up paneling, you know, that sort of blonde 1950s paneling. So when we started working on the house, our goal was to put back this room to what we believed it looked like, but we had a lot of detective work to do. We took out that drop ceiling, and we saw this gorgeous ceiling up there. This is original. It was about 85% intact, and we really had very little work to do on it. But the walls, when we took that paneling off, were completely bare. And I'm going to pass around some photos. What we discovered was some ghosting of where something had been on these walls, but we didn't have much of a clue until we came across this photograph here. It's a little bit hard to see in the dark at night, but this is a photograph of, let me see if I can turn this light on that might help. This is a photograph of Beatrice and Catherine Ayer. They're the two daughters that grew up in this house from Mr. Ayer's second marriage. By the way, Beatrice went on to marry General George Patton. And the Patton family is still very much involved in the restoration of the house. But this photograph was in the family collection. There are about 250 descendants of the heirs, and they all seem to have one piece of this house. And when we explained to them that there was something on the walls, we just don't know what, somebody put two and two together and realized that this photograph had been taken in this room. This is Beatrice, as I mentioned, Beatrice and Catherine, they're standing, sitting at a piano that was just about right here. And luckily, the photograph shows a lot of the background of the room. It shows, this is a copy, so it's not that clear, but the original is crystal clear. We could see how the wainscoting worked. We could see that there were light fixtures, and we could also see that there was fabric on the walls. At the same time, another family member said, "Hey, I have the inventory for your house." And it's a 435-page inventory. It's every item in this house. It's so detailed that it describes this as Japanese gold cloth on the walls here. So with the inventory and this photograph, we were really able to recreate a lot of this room, and of course also the ghosting that you can see in that photograph. The other interesting pieces of the photograph are, of course, showing the light fixtures that were in here. Of course, Tiffany did all the light fixtures in the house. These are, it's probably hard for you to see, but they're also described in the inventory as 13 armed wall sconces with Faverolle shades. Faverolle is that glass technique that Tiffany pioneered. There were five of them, and we have have stand-in fixtures here. We found the original outlets that were there. In all likelihood, when the insurance company got in this room, they threw those out. And that's the way people felt about Tiffany in the 1950s. Just too fussy. But we're always on the prowl for them, so if you ever see one, let us know. We'd like to get them back. But the other wonderful thing about the photograph is the bench that the girls are sitting on, the piano bench, is part of a set of Louis Seize furniture, classic French furniture for this French drawing. When we did research on it, though, we discovered that this is part of a set that Tiffany was marketing at the time. Tiffany marketed everything. If you couldn't afford to have him do your whole house, you could buy a carpet from him, you could buy a set of furniture, you could buy curtains, you could buy light fixtures. But if he was doing your house, he would do everything. So we know that he also put his own furniture styles that he was designing or selling in this house as well. We also just recently, which is really fun, discovered a letter in the family archives of Mr. Eyre writing to his wife. He's on a business trip in New York from the Plaza Hotel, and he writes, I just met with Mr. Tiffany about the new curtains for the drawing. So even as time went on, they were consulting with Tiffany about how to redo the curtains and all sorts of things. So every detail was sort of handed to Tiffany to take care of. Also, we took this to a clothing historian because we weren't sure about the date in the photograph. And she said, oh, this could probably be about 1910, just based on the size of the girl's sleeves, which I just thought was absolutely fascinating. And then I took her to a Boston clothing historian, and she said, well, it could be a little bit, or it could be a little bit later. And the reason is because in Boston, you never wanted to appear gauche and wear the most current fashion. So what you could do is you'd go to London or New York and buy all your clothing, and then you'd come back to Boston and you'd sit on it for a year because you didn't want to be too trendy. That's considered gauche. So if they were following that trend, that may have been the case. You can't see it, but we did see it from the outside. There's wonderful stained glass in this room that was all designed for the house. Of course, Tiffany incorporated stained glass into a lot of his residential commissions. You can just make it out there. There are two patterns on there, as I mentioned, the same patterns in the mosaics outside. There's one that, with a round pattern, and then there's one with a more rectilinear pattern. And we call one the starburst and one the cruciform, and I'll show you those designs as they go through our house. But very, very exotic in feeling. Stained glass, by the way, you can't see it, but the central window is made up of about 3,000 pieces of glass. We have right now, these are pieces of plastic. When we had to take down the central window a couple of years ago because it was buckling terribly, and it's now in storage, and we're hoping to put it back in the next couple of years after we've restored it to showcase it. The reason we had to take it down was that buckling, and the reason these windows are buckling is because of the way they're constructed. Unlike stained glass windows in churches where they use lead, because they're using big pieces of glass that need to be adjoined, they used instead copper foil because they were using tiny little pieces of glass. These pieces of glass are about the size each of a dime or a nickel. And to connect those, you can't use those big pieces of lead. You have to use something really thin, so they use copper foil, which is the same technique that they use on the Tiffany lampshades. It's wonderful because it allows you to do this really intricate work, but the downside is it's very, very delicate. So using it outside is just asking for trouble. And sure enough, we're gonna have to restore that window before we put it back. We don't have the two side windows, and the story goes that somebody approached the insurance company and asked if they could have them. And the CEO said, sure, take them. He really just couldn't care less. And they climbed up, and we think they just took the two smaller windows because they couldn't get that center window. It was so heavy. I can testify, it's huge. So we're really lucky that they didn't take the central one, but we're always looking for the smaller one, so if you see them, let us know. We'd like them back. The other great piece we have in here is photographs of Mr. and Mrs. Eyre at the time they moved into this house. Mr. Eyre was in his 70s. He always had these huge mutton chop beards. That was his signature look. He was a classic American rags to riches story. He was born to a really poor family in Connecticut. And in fact, his mother had to farm him out to relatives to take care of him. He went through a sixth grade education and then joined forces with his brother, James, who became a doctor. And the two of them founded a patent medicine company, Ayers Patent Medicines. Now there were hundreds, you know, almost 1,000, probably more patent medicine companies at that time in the United States, but theirs rose to the top. And largely because of Frederick's marketing strategies. He traveled all over the place, made personal pitches about his products, and really was wildly successful. Their most successful product was called Cherry Pectoral, and it was supposed to help everything that ailed your lungs. It was 3% heroin. But they weren't doing anything illegal at the time. Everybody was using opiates and these drugs. What they were doing that was slightly different was that they were listing some of their ingredients on the label, which was really, this was long before the FDA, but this was part of Mr. Ayer's marketing strategy. If you know what I do and what I have and what I am, then you'll trust me. Now, I should note, on the opposite side of that is that their other most famous product was called Ayer's Hair Vigor, and it was supposed to turn all your gray hair back to its original color. Enough for honesty. He then poured all the money into the textile industry, and he bought up factories throughout New England and modernized them, and became wildly successful in the textile industry. In fact, their companies held a monopoly on producing fabric for the U.S. Army through the Korean War. So he made millions for his descendants as well. And he also invested heavily in land. For instance, he owned 40 parcels here in Boston, including the Elliott Hotel across the street. He owned several parcels right next to Mrs. Gardner. So he was, you know, really going out pretty far flung in areas, uncharted areas of Boston. And certainly owning property here at the time that this property was built was a little bit uncharted too, because this was, as I explained, this was sort of the end of Com Ave. This was where people stopped building and were just starting to look to build more. He also was on the board of some very famous companies, the first board of AT&T, for instance. He foresaw that the telephone was going to take off, and sure enough it did. I like to describe him as like, he would be today the 95-year-old with an iPhone. You know, he was tireless and was interested in new technology. His wife, but he was very quiet. People often speculated about his wealth and how much he owned because he wouldn't tell anybody. So if you Google him in the New York Times archives, you'll find social columns where the socialites are all speculating about how much he was worth. But his wife, his second wife, was anything but quiet. She was, as I might have mentioned, a trained actress, and she had a very regal bearing. She's always photographed with these huge hats with lots of feathers and carrying roses because she cultivated roses. But she was known for just being really out there. And her grandchildren have several notations in their diaries about how grandma kept us waiting at the dinner table for 20 minutes, you know, and then made a grand entrance, and then chose to talk to somebody really loudly and embarrass them. And she was just quite a character. The way they met is equally as interesting. She was 28 and unmarried. He had heard about her through a mutual friend. But this was an era when you were 28, you were really in danger of becoming a spinster. And he approached her he wrote a letter to her asking her out to a dinner party. And now you're a spinster, and one of the wealthiest men in the world is asking you out to dinner. You'd think she'd say yes, but she said no. She had plans that evening to go to the theater to see Edwin Booth. Edwin Booth was all the rage in those days. Everybody admired him, despite his connection with his brother, John Wilkes Booth. And he was performing that evening in Hamlet, which was his signature role, and she wasn't going to miss it. So she went to the theater, and he was so impressed that she had turned it down that he went to the theater. He waited until the performance was over, and then he went and introduced himself with a chaperone, of course, and said, "Now that you've had the pleasure of seeing Edwin Booth perform, I hope I can have the pleasure of your company at dinner." And they went to dinner, and they were married 4 months later. The other interesting piece we have in the house is owned by a family member. This is just a copy, but it's a watercolor. As I mentioned, Tiffany, already by 1918, was falling out of favor. By 1932, he couldn't sell anything anymore and went bankrupt. And then a year later, in 1933, he died. But when his firm went bankrupt, a lot of items were sold, given away, or dispersed, or thrown out. It was a mess. And so there is no central place where you can go and do research about Tiffany, because it just doesn't exist in one place. But every now and then you happen upon something that sort of helps fill in the gaps and helps us understand more about how he worked. And this is such a piece This is a watercolor signed by Renee de Calais. Renee was Tiffany's lead designer for residential work. And written in pencil on the back of it is smoking room at the Air Mansion. So this was Tiffany's proposal for what he wanted the smoking room in this house to look like. Now, in all likelihood, there was a whole set of these watercolors because this is how Tiffany probably worked. Now, this is long before computer-aided design, so how do you show your clients what you want to do for them? You commission a watercolor. So we're lucky to have this one, and we don't have any others, but we have this one because this room was completely demolished by the insurance company. So we don't know if it was ever built. It was on the top floor of this house. All these big houses had either a billiard room or a smoking room on the top floor. That was considered all the rage. You can see what Tiffany wanted to do here. He didn't want to just add in a few exotic elements. He wanted to make you feel like you were walking right into smoking den in Marrakesh. And actually, Tiffany's own house and studio looked very much like this, with lots of exotic elements. We did, however, have a chance to get a few more clues as to whether or not this was built. When we were working on the facade, I needed to know how the top of the facade was affixed to the building. So I needed to get up and look at the roof line from the interior of the building. So what we did is we went up there, there's a ceiling that was added by the insurance company that's just about this height here. So it's a huge room, a huge ceiling. And I took a drill and I drilled a hole and then I stuck my camera up and I took photographs of everything I could see. And what we discovered was that there was remnants, like you'd seen in that photograph, of where ghosting of where this frieze had been. There's ghosting of where these archways were and the tops of columns. So we suspect it was probably built pretty much the way you see it here. The big surprise though was that we discovered when we took those photographs that there's a big covered item in there that runs the whole length of the ceiling. It turns out that it's a glass ceiling. It's a skylight up there. So what we're actually looking at in this photograph, we always thought we were looking at a painted ceiling. What you're looking at is a glass ceiling in a nighttime scene, which is typical. But you know, that's when you'd be in the smoking room, is at night. That was usually the time you'd be using. So that is still up there, we believe, because it's been roofed over on top of the roof and then boarded up from below.
But it would have been open to the sky.
I'm sorry?
Would the glass ceiling have been open to the sky?
Yes, yes. So that's where you're looking at a night sky for a glass ceiling in this image. We don't have the funds and we don't have the ability right now to open that up. At some point we'll get to it and we'll see if it's still there. I don't know if any of you have been to the Cultural Center in Chicago. This extraordinary Tiffany design glass ceiling. I don't think it's not quite as ornate, but it's probably along those lines. Lastly, I just want to show you this door. This is, there were some dreadful 1950s doors in here when we started working. We took that out, and lo and behold, the original door was still there, just stuffed into the wall. We call this preservation by neglect. Come on out to the hallway, and I'll show you that space. We'll be coming back down for drinks too. So. But this is the front hall. Of course, this is one of our prized possessions. This room was all Tiffany designed as well. All the inlay work that you see in the plaster, on the mantelpiece behind you, on the risers here, and up on this archway behind me, this is all Tiffany glass. And it's backed with gold foil. That's what gives it this beautiful iridescence. We have a terrible lighting system here, but it's really absolutely exquisite. All hand done, of course, probably all made and designed in New York City, and then brought down here and installed in place. This room was not as empty as you see it.
It originally had hundreds of objects in it, and we know that because of the inventory. So there were leopard skins on the floor, there were hookah pipes and brass vases, there was furniture designed by Tiffany, and there was even a stuffed jaguar in here that measured 7.5 feet from the tip of its tail to the tip of its nose. I can't figure out where this thing lived with all the other things going on in here. So my speculation is that it was on the mantle, which would have been totally fitting for just a super exotic setting. Now, the reason Tiffany did this, it was his own interest in exoticism. He had traveled through Egypt as a young man, and he had seen all these kinds of things. But the heirs had also just finished traveling in Europe and northern Africa as well. They had even taken a barge down the Nile, which was all rage in that age. Mrs. Gardner did the same thing. And they had amassed this collection of all these objects, and they needed a place to show it off that would be fitting. So Tiffany was creating that space for them. You get the sense of a mosque in here, don't you? It has the rounded corners, the inlay, the designs, very, very similar to some of the work you might see in the Middle East. The lighting in here is also Tiffany designed and it's original. The vases miraculously survived through multiple owners. They are designed as you see them, which are vases with an open base into which a light bulb was inserted. They're Tiffany designed as well. There were originally three of them, and we know that because the inventory describes three of them. And the third sat on that niche right by the doorway there. Unfortunately, we think that the insurance company owner, as he left the building after he sold it, took it with him. We have been trying to track it down, and luckily, we just recently found it. It was sold out of our hands. We tried to get a hold of it, but it was sold to a Tiffany fund members. The other light fixture that's original to the house, of course, is this wonderful one up in the center. It goes all the way up 5 stories, and in the inventory, it's described as ending in a stained glass skylight. So originally, there was stained glass up there, but that must have collapsed and fallen out. And the insurance company luckily took that out, but left the central fixture. I think this is so modern in sensibility. Think about it, this is 1899, but it looks like the 1930s to me. And I think what gives it that modern modernity is these raw pieces of glass that are sticking out of it. Tiffany, by the way, called these glass jewels. And he understood jewelry because his dad was Charles Tiffany, the founder of Tiffany & Company, the jewelry company. His dad wanted him to become a jeweler, but Louis was like, no thanks, I'm going to do my own thing. So he went off and did his own thing, but when his dad died, he actually ran Tiffany & Company for about 6 or 7 years. And that's when he did this extraordinary butterfly, and I mean, dragonfly jewelry, pins, and hair pieces, and he did some really amazing things. But they were so non-traditional for Tiffany & Company that actually many designers drummed him out. And to this day, Tiffany & Company doesn't advertise that Louis Comfort Tiffany ran their business because he's considered so commercial. But now you all know the truth. If you look at that fixture, you can see those two motifs that I was telling you about. And the globe is that cruciform motif, and then right underneath is the starburst. And they're also repeated in the mantelpiece. So these designs are very subtly being used by Tiffany throughout the house. So you get that sense of continuity. You've seen this somewhere before. Oh, everything is connected, even though they're disparate styles of rooms. The other lighting that was in the room was in this archway here. You can see there used to be a light bulb just about every foot. And the reason for that was because this was a stage. This is where Mrs. Gardner performed. She, in her, given her economic situation, she would never have performed on a stage. That would have been considered inappropriate. But she would perform privately for her friends and little soirees. And Tiffany designed a stage for her. You can hear the acoustics are really quite amazing. Tiffany understood theater design, by the way. He designed the first all-electrified theater called the Lyceum in New York City with Edison. So he knew how to do those precision marches. There were two hidden doors, one on either side, you can see, where people could make entrance and exits. And this was also Mrs. Eyre's flower arranging room, and we know that because the inventory lists all the items in there, all right down to her scissors. She always kept two huge vases of roses on either side here, and lots of plants and flowers because she loved flowers. And through those double doors was originally the dining room. Unfortunately, that room was also guided by the insurance company, and we have no photographs. If we come across someone, might be able to do something with it, but Right now, all we have are the original doors. But so when the air is entertained and it slide open, those doors slide open these and have this whole space available for entertainment. But come on upstairs and sit on the, if you want to sit on the stairs here on either side of the mosaic, I'll tell you a little bit about this mosaic.
And stand and look down on that balcony up there if you'd like. There's not enough room. So this mosaic is really one of our piece de resistance. This is also designed by Tiffany, of course, for the house as a backdrop for Mrs. Eyre's performances. This is sort of the classic Roman Greek backdrop to a stage. And also probably was designed to look like a garden, a folly in a garden. So it was really appropriate with Mrs. Eyre's interest in plants and flowers. When I do lectures and show this on a slide, people can't believe that it's flat because he really did a remarkable job of fooling you into thinking it's 3D. The way he does that is, first of all, in variations in colors, you can see he makes it look like a shadow on the dome here. And then he also uses some slightly 3D elements. These columns are popping ever so slightly out into the room. They're curved glass. And they're backed with gold foil, which also gives it a sense of depth. And then between each one of the columns is a glass block that's about 3 inches deep, and it's mirrored on 5 sides. So you're actually just getting whatever's reflected in front of it, but because the glass is modeled, you can't tell that you're looking at a reflection. It looks like you're looking right through the columns beyond. The other way that Tiffany made you feel like you were outdoors was this wonderful skylight above us. This is actually called a ley light. A ley light is a piece of glass that's internal, and above it is an atrium, and there's a skylight on the roof, and a skylight is what's exposed to the air.